What you understood by garbage collector? So they will ask, what is garbage collector? You should say, garbage collector is the internal daemon thread. Once in a while, it is going to come to the heap memory, scanning the entire heap memory for abandoned object. What is the abandoned object? Abandoned object, there is no reference. An object without any reference. That is what we are calling dead object or abandoned object. On that object, garbage collector will be calling the finalize method. On that object, garbage collector will be calling the finalize method as the last step. There also, if that object is not getting the reference, then that object will be removed from the memory. Then that object will be removed from the heap memory. Then, what is resurrected object? Resurrected. What is resurrected object? Definition, what is the resurrected object? Which is dead and not having reference. What is that? Already dead object is somehow getting the reference. Whenever we are calling the finalize method, it is getting the reference, coming back to life. That is what we are calling the resurrected object. So on the resurrected object, finalize method won't be calling. Finalize method won't be calling. On any object, finalize method will be calling only once. If any resurrected object is there, directly it is going to be removed from the memory without calling the finalize method. Now, We talk about the clone method. Clone. Clone. Clone method. What is the clone method? Where clone method is available? Clone. Carefully observe here. Object class. What are the methods are we have? In the object class, we have the clone method. We have the clone method. Creates and returns a copy of current object. Creates and returns a copy of this object means current object. Creates and returns a copy of this object. Clone method. Clone method return type is object type. Clone method return type is object type. Now, clone will be throwing the clone not supported exception. Clone not supported exception. Creates and returns a copy of this object. Now, what is the general meaning of clone? Clone means a copy, right? Clone. I want an exact clone of this thing. I want an exact clone of this thing. Here, we are making a clone of one object. We are making a clone of one object. We are trying to make a clone of one object. Clone. Now, this statement is the checked type of exception. This statement is the checked type of exception. That is why we are getting the error. Unhandled exception type. Clone not supported exception. At throws declaration. Otherwise, keep try catch. Now, clone is a statement which is causing the checked type of exception. If any checked type of exception is there, that method should be kept as throws. Throws. We can either go for throwable or exception, or particular class, clone not supported exception. Clone method is a checked type of exception causing statement. Either we need throws or try catch. Now, clone method. Clone method return type is object type. Clone method return type is object type. Now, B class is extending object class. Now, the clone method return type is what? Object class. That object should be downcasted to B. We can able to downcast now? Of course we can able to downcast. Why? Because B is extending object. But here, what is the error? Clone. I should keep the throws here, or I should keep this statement within the try catch. So I'll comment this line. Come to the C. What I'm trying to do. Here I'm keeping throws, clone not supported exception. Either you can go for throwable or exception or clone not supported exception. Now I'm trying to make an exact copy of the C object. C C1 is equal to new C. Now, after that, I'm printing one, simply one. Then what I'm trying to do? I'm making an exact copy of C1 by using C1.clone. I'm calling a clone method on the C1 object.
I'm calling clone method on the C1 object. Now it is making an exact copy of the C1. Now that is, we are downcasting into C type. Directly we cannot assign to C type. Why? Because the return type is object type. We need to downcast first to the C type. Then only we can assign to C type. Now C2 will be having the copy, exact same copy, but different object. Carefully observe. This is different object. This is different object. But both are same. Object is different. Both are entirely different objects. That means C1 and C2 are not pointing to the same object. C1 and C2 are both pointing to the different objects. But objects are same. C1 is pointing to one object, C2 is pointing to another object. But both the objects are same. Reference is different. Both the references are pointing to different objects. Next, I will print to then done. Clone not supported exception. Why we are getting this clone not supported exception? Why I'm getting this clone not supported exception? To achieve the cloning, we need to follow some rules. Now, the first and foremost, this clone statement, if you are keeping in a method, that should be throwing clone not supported exception or keep the throws or exception class. Otherwise, you should keep this inside the try catch block. Then, second rule is clone method return type is object type. When you downcast the C type. Okay. Now, what is other rule? Here D class implements clonable. Clonable is the interface. Clonable is an interface. D class implements clonable. Clonable interface available in java.lang package. It is a marker interface. What is the marker interface? We call an interface as the marker interface when it doesn't have any members, when it is empty. Those interfaces we are calling it as marker interface. It is just providing a mark and providing us the type. Means this class is the clonable type. You can make a clone of this class object mark. We are marking. We are using the clonable as the mark. Like this class object is eligible for cloning operation. This class object, D class object, is eligible for cloning operation. Clonable is an interface, marker interface. What is the marker interface? It is the empty interface, doesn't have any members. We are just using it for marking purpose. It is only providing us the mark and it is providing us the type. Now, when I'm implementing this clonable, now it becomes type of clonable. D is becoming the type of clonable. Now, whichever the class is implementing clonable interface, those are the classes are eligible for cloning operation. Now here, what this means, in order to specify something to the runtime environment, make the class as clonable so that that runtime environment allows this class for cloning operation. That runtime environment make that class as clonable. It will allow the class for cloning operation. Now, try to execute F11. What we are getting? D1, D2. D1 got stored in some memory location. D2 got stored in another memory location, but objects are same. Objects, see, what are the steps you need to follow? First step, we need to use the throws, otherwise keep that clone inside the try catch. Next, we need to downcast the return type, right? We need to downcast the return value to the specified type. Return type is object to type. Clone method return type is object to type. We need to downcast to the specified type. That is second. Next, what is next? If I want to make a class eligible for cloning operation, we need to make that class implement clonable. That class must be implementing clonable interface. What is clonable interface? It is the marker interface. What is marker interface? Marker interface means it doesn't have any members. For example, observe carefully here, clonable. I'll show you how it is. Clonable. Clonable. See? Interface clonable. A class implements the clonable interface to indicate object.clone method. That is, it is legal for that method to make a field for field copy of instances of that class. Simply, it is saying that if a class is implementing this clonable interface, that class is eligible for cloning operation, making the copy operation. Now, as you can see, we don't have any members, right, Aram? We don't have any members. We don't have the field. We don't have the method, right, Aram? Anything. We don't have anything. We don't have anything. That is why we are calling it as marker interface. Marker interface. What is marker interface? It doesn't have any members, empty interface. It is used for just marking purpose. It is just giving us the mark. It is just giving us the mark. It is just giving us the mark. When an object becomes type of clonable, we can perform the cloning operation on that object. We can perform the cloning operation on that object. Okay, these many rules. Carefully observe. In type, in the G class, in type non-static, now G class object, obj 1.type field, initializing 10, then G type obj 2. Now calling the clone method on obj 1. I can call the clone method on obj 1. Why? Because this G class is implementing clonable. Now it is eligible for cloning operation. Now I'm downcasting the object return value to the G type, then only I'm assigning to obj 2. Now we have made an exact copy of the previous object obj 1. Now A colon obj 2 dot I means what? That means if I make a clone of the previous object, if I make a clone of obj1 object, whatever the contents are there in that object will be copied to the new object. This int I also copied to the new object. While saying obj2, I can access I. Possible. Now, if I say obj2.i, what will be the value? 10. Now obj2.i 20. But if you try to print obj1.i, it will be 10 only. Why? Because both are different objects. One object modification doesn't reflect into another object. Then obj1.i 30. Now obj2.i remains 20 only. A colon obj 2 dot I 10, B colon obj 1 dot I, obj 1 dot I 10 only, but here obj 2 dot I 20. Now if you print obj 1 dot I, what will you get? 30, right or wrong? Both are different objects. Please go through this theory. Here, what is happening? I'm calling clone method on the obj1. Now it is making an exact copy of the obj1 object, storing inside the obj2. Now, obj1 is pointing to one object, obj2 is pointing to another object. Both are different objects, but same copy. Now, in the obj1 also we have int I. In obj2 also we have int I. But obj 1.i already set to 10. That is only copied to obj 2. That is also copying to obj 2. Now if you call obj 2.i, I value is 10 only. Then obj 2.i I'm modifying to 20. If you call obj 1.i, that remains 10 only. Now I'm modifying obj 1.i to 30. If you call obj 2.i, that is 20 only. If you call obj 1.i, that is 30. Modification of one object does not reflect to the other object. Why? Because those are independent objects. Initially they are same when I copy. After that we are making the changes to those objects individually. One object changes is not reflecting to another object. What is happening in this case? Index we have. Careful observe this one. Index we have. I class implements clonable. I class implements clonable. Now, I has H attribute. I has H attribute. H space H1. I has H1. Now carefully observe. Carefully observe. Now what we are going to do? Here we are performing the shallow copy. Shallow copy operation. Shallow copy. How we are achieving? By using derived attributes. Derived attributes. How we are achieving? This program is performing the shallow copy. How we are achieving a shallow copy operation? If there is any derived type of attribute, through that derived type of attribute, we are achieving the shallow copy operation. I class is having one attribute, only one attribute, that is of type H. That is of type H. If a class is containing derived data type, then we can able to perform the shallow copy operation by using that derived type of attribute. Now, what is shallow copy? Shallow copy means changes in one reflecting to another. Changes in one object reflecting to another object. Here, two types of copies are there. One is shallow copy, another one is deep copy. To achieve shallow copy, compulsory we should be having the derived type of attributes. To achieve the deep copy, we should have the primitive type of attributes. Here we are first seeing the shallow copy. Shallow copy. How we are getting the shallow copy? Class H we have, non-static index we have. Class H we have, non-static H, sorry, non-static X we have. Class I implements clonable. Now, H class H1. H class H1 attribute we have. Now, I class has the H type of attribute. I class has one attribute. I class has one attribute, that is the type of H. I class, one attribute, that is the type of H type. I has H. I has H type. I has H type. Creating the object for I. Creating the object for I. OBJ1 is pointing to an I object. OBJ1 is pointing to an I object. Now OBJ1 dot H1 is equal to new H. By using OBJ1, I can access H1. Right or wrong? By using OBJ1, I can access the H1. How? Whenever I'm creating the object for I, all the non-static, all the attributes will be loaded to the memory. Now this is also loading to the memory. Now, by using OBJ1, I can access H1. By using reference, I can access this field or not? I can access that field, OBJ1.H1. For that H1, I'm assigning H type. H1 can hold H type or not, right? H1 can hold H type, that is why I'm assigning H object to the OBJ1.H1, OBJ1.H1, not for OBJ1, carefully observe, not for OBJ1, OBJ1.H1, OBJ1.H1. Then what I'm doing, OBJ1.H1.X. Whenever you are trying to create the object for H, non-static member of the H class also loading. Whenever you are trying to create the object for H, non-static member of the H class also loading. That is X. Then what you are doing? By using obj1.h1, you are accessing the X. obj1. Dot H1.
obj1.h1. By using obj1.h1, you are accessing x. Here, h1 is the h type. Now what you have done? You have created the h object, right or wrong? You have created the h object. Now all the non-static variables of the h will be loaded or not? Loaded. That object I'm assigning to obj1.h1. Now h1 will be containing this x or not? Right or wrong? Alvin Ray, Shobita. obj1.h1 will be containing this index also. Why? Because whenever you are getting the object into h class, this non-static member also loading. Then loaded object. Object is loading. Then non-static member is also loading. Then that total object I'm assigning to obj1.h1. By using obj1.h1, I can access h. Here, h1 pointing to what? H object. Right or wrong? H1 now pointing to what? H object. In that object, we have the index or not? Yes. That is how we are accessing obj1.h1.x. That is equal to 10. If you try to print, obj1.h1.x, you'll get 0. Carefully observe. Here. Try to print. What you are getting? Observe carefully. Will we get 0 initially? Whenever it is loaded with the 0 only. That is why I'm getting the 0. Now I'm initializing with the 10. Then what I'm trying to do? I'm creating the clone of I object. We can make a clone of I object, not the H object. We can make a clone of the I object, not the H object. Why? Because I implementing the clonable, not the H. I'm calling the clone method on the obj1. Now it is making an exact copy of the obj1. Then that is stored inside the obj2. Now what we have? We have h1 also and we have x also. In this object obj1, we have h1 also and we have h1.x also. Now carefully observe obj2.h1.x. Current value of obj1.h1.x is what? 10. The same thing copied to obj2, that is why obj2.h1.x also 10. And then obj1.h1.x 20. Now carefully observe what it is. What I'm trying to do. Why we are getting the 20 here? obj1.h1.x 20. Now, if you print obj2.h1.x, it is also 20. How? That is okay.
cloning is okay. But here, in the previous examples, we have seen that if I clone, that are those are individual objects. But here, changes are visible. Whatever the changes I make to one object, that is visible to another object also. Why? Why? Carefully observe. Now, what I'm trying to do. OBJ 1 also has the H1 reference. OBJ 2 also has the H1 reference. OBJ 1 also has the H1 reference. OBJ 2 also has the H1 reference. Yes, sir, but right now, actually, I'm in a class, actually. I'm in a class, actually. Maybe I can call at 5 o'clock. Yes, sir, yes. Means, sir, yeah. Not recently, sir. Not recently. Maybe before 1 year back, it seems. I don't know exactly. Sure, sir. Yeah. Oh,
number, sir?
It is BOGPB9977Q. B for Bombay, O for Orange, G for Crepes, B for Pilot, B for Violet, Violet, yeah, B for Violet, 9977Q for Queen. Yes, sir. Yeah, sure, sure. No issues, sir. No issues. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone wants to go in this what is that? Take service desk. You know what is service desk? It's a kind of tech support. Means it is desktop. It is not like a telephone support. It is like a network. But not exactly the network, but kind of desktop support. I got called at Mindtree. Actually, before I also worked as a system admin for some, not much. So here, what we are achieving, shallow copy, what this means, OBJ1 also has the H1, OBJ2 also. OBJ2 also, where is OBJ2? This one. OBJ2 also has the H1. I'll then read. OBJ1 dot H. Again, what I'm trying to do. OBJ1 dot H, for that OBJ1 dot H, I have assigned one H object. I have assigned one H object. Then by using H1, definitely I can able to access the X. Definitely I can able to access the H. The same object I'm cloning to OBJ2. The same object I'm cloning. Making one exact copy of OBJ1, then I'm supplying to OBJ2. Now what I'm trying to do? We have two objects. We have two objects. Carefully observe, we have two objects. But this X is the same. In both the objects, we have the reference to H1. In both the objects, we have the reference H1. Now what I'm trying to do? By using OBJ2, I'm trying to make the changes for H1.x.
Earlier, obj1.h1.x is 10. Now what I'm trying to do? obj2.h1.x, current value is 10. That is only it is printing. Now, by saying obj1.h1.x 20. If you try to print obj2.h1.x, that is 20 only. X value is changing. X value is changing. How it is changing? Because of the h1 reference. We have h1 reference in both the objects, obj1 also, obj2 also. By using that reference, I can make the changes to x. I can make the changes to x. I am making the changes to x attribute of the h class by using h1 reference. H1 reference we have in both the objects. We have in both the objects. Objects are different, pakka different. Pakka different. But for the same attribute only, we are making the changes. For the same attribute only, we are making the changes. Now, obj2.h1.x. obj2.h1.x, current value is 20. obj2.h1.x, current value is 20. And then, I'm making the modification, obj2.h1.x, 230. Now, if you try to access obj1.h1.x, that is 30 only. See what we are trying to achieve here. Shallow copy operation. If any derived attributes are there, this program performing the shallow copy operation. By using derived attributes, we are achieving the shallow copy. I class having only one attribute, that is of type H. I class is having only one attribute. Derived attribute of type H, of type H. If a class contains a derived type, then we'll be getting a shallow copy operation. How? Changes in one reflecting to the another. Carefully observe. Understanding or not? I don't want job. You want job? You want job?
Here, I is having H1 attribute. Now, initially, what I have done, obj1.clone, sorry. Initially, I created one I object, obj1. obj1.h1, I can able to access h1 through obj1 reference. For that, I'm creating the new object. In that object, we have the index. So, that object directly I'm assigning to obj1.h1. obj1.h1. then printing the obj 1.h1.x, that is 0 only. Then obj 1.h1.x 10, we are modifying. Then here comes the twist. Obj 2 is equal to obj 1.clone. Obj 1.clone. Now what is happening in this case? What is happening in this case? We are making an exact copy of obj 1. We are making an exact copy of obj 1. Inside the obj 1, we have this attribute h1 of type h. The same, it is copied, the same object is copied, then we are creating the new object. That object we are assigning to obj2. Then what I'm trying to do, currently, if you're accessing the obj2.h1.x, same object only, right? Same object only. There we have modified the x value to 10. That is why obj2.h1.x also 10. Then what I'm doing? obj1.h1.x 20. Now what happens? For the second object also, values changed. X value got changed. Earlier it was 10, now it is 20. That means what? Both the objects are having H1 reference. By using any of the reference, you can able to modify the x value. Both are obj1 also having the h1 reference, obj2 also having the h1 reference. By using any of the reference, you can able to modify the x value. Reflecting back to both objects, the result will be reflecting to both objects. That is why here obj2.h1.x, it is 20. Now what I'm trying to do? By using obj2.h1, I'm trying to modify the x value 30. Now obj1.h1.x value also changed. That is why we are getting 30 for obj1.h1.x. Understood this? You see, it is very important, you know, should analyze how we are making, how it is happening. No, because of the reference attribute, derived type of attribute. That is why we are achieving the shallow copy means what? Changes in one reflecting to another. So you can also consider that one as call by reference or pass by reference. If and only if I have the reference, then only we can achieve that. See, some theory is there. You should read this one. It is very important. What we are achieving through clone method. What we are achieving through clone method. Original object can be copied through clone operation. Original object can be copied through clone operation. And we are making the duplicate object through clone method. Now, object class contains built-in cloning operation. How we are achieving? By using the clone method. What we are doing exactly? There is a clone method. Inside the object class, there is a clone method inside the object class. There is a clone method inside the object class. We can copy the content into another place without a constructor execution. See, usually what happens, if you want to make an exact copy of one object, we need the constructors. We need the constructors. How? How? By using constructor. How? In copy martira, usually. I need to make a copy of one object. Sir, we'll see that. Now, internally, runtime environment, somehow it is creating the new object from the original object. How it is doing? It is copying the existing object and it is making a clone of that original object. If I try to do that object cloning manually, it takes a lot of time, because consider if an object contains hundreds of attributes, not only one or two, it might contain hundreds or thousands of attributes. Now what we need to do, first step, we need to create that object with those 100 attributes, then we can create the new object and copy all the attributes to that newly created object. How? See, already one object is there. Inside that object, we have hundreds of attributes. I want to make an exact copy of that original object. Now we'll be creating another object. We'll be creating another object with those 100 attributes. And what we need to do? Copy all the attributes to that newly created object. Copy all the attributes to those newly created object. Now, if it is for one or two attributes, that is fine. But if it is hundreds or thousands of attributes, it is not the practical approach. It is not the practical approach. That is why we are using the clone. That is why we are using the clone. What it does? Clone method returns a duplicate object, copied object from the original object. Now, what are the conditions we need to follow in order to achieve the cloning? Straight away, object class clone method cannot be used. Straight away, we cannot able to use the object class clone method. What are the conditions we need to follow? We know the conditions, right? Three conditions we have. First, what? Throws or try catch. Then we need to convert that to specific type, from objective to specific type. Then what we need to do? That the class should be implementing the clonable type, clonable interface. Then only we can make the object clonable. Now carefully observe what happens. In case of cloning operation, security issue. Security issue. What happens? Assume that for one house, we have two keys. Okay. Now, both the keys we should maintain properly. If I lose one key, also security issue. By using any of one of the key, I can open the door. Right, anyone can open the door. So security issue. That is why, in the production, they will avoid the cloning operation. Okay. Now, clone method is the product method in the object class. Then it has to use in the subclass only. Okay, then it has to be used in the subclass only. Clone method is the protected. You cannot use inside the non-subclass. Protected member can use inside the non-subclass. Same package non-subclass, protected. Possible? Same package non-subclass. Possible or not? I sent you that list now. Not possible, no? Access specifier we have. Here, observe here, protected, carefully observe, same package non-subclass is possible, but different package non-subclass is not possible, okay, different package non-subclass is not possible. Clone method is the protected method in the object class, then it has to be used in the subclass only. That means what? That should be used immediately wherever I am inheriting, in that class only I need to use. Wherever I am inheriting, in that class only I need to use. Okay, answer here.
the method clone from the type object is not visible. Why? Because, carefully observe. Wherever you are inheriting the objective class, clone method, there only you should use. In the subclass only you should use. Now M1 extends object, but here I'm trying to create the object for A, not the M1. If you try to make a clone of M1, that is fine. But we are trying to make a clone of A in the M1 class. Not possible. M1 also extending object. But here, clone method, I'm calling on which object? A1 object. Not the M1 object. Wherever clone got inherited, there only we should use. Assume here M1 is extending A. See? Now what happened? A is extending object. M1 is extending A. We know very well. In case of protected, members, wherever you are inheriting, there only you should use. Okay? Wherever you are inheriting, in the subclass only you should use. Not in the next subclass. Immediate subclass only you can use. Okay? In the packages and access levels, you know. In the immediate subclass only you can use the protected member. Not in the next subclass. Wherever clone method is inheriting, there only we should use. We are inheriting the clone method in the M1. Not in the A. If you are using this statement inside the A, that is fine. But we are using the clone method on M1, inside M1, If you are making a clone of M1, that is fine. Okay. Object class clone method also inheriting to M1. But I'm not creating the M1 object. I'm not trying to make a clone of M1. I'm trying to make a clone of A. Then you should use that clone method inside the A only, not inside the M1. If you are keeping this here, after carefully, what we will get here, comment this, what is the error? Type mismatch, cannot convert from object to A. This we know, right? Simply you can able to keep what A. Then you'll get what? Default constructor cannot handle exception type, clone up supported exception. We need to give what? Yes, throws we need to give. Right? Throws we need to give. Yes. Now we need to give the explicit constructor for this. That means what? I need to create the A here. For this, throws. Exception. Now it is fine. Okay. I'm trying to do. Clone method is what? Protected. Wherever you are inheriting, there itself we should use. Not in another class. What is the error?
No, sir. Reflection API. Reflection API. We'll come to last topic of the objective class, reflection API. Here inside the java.lang package we have the object class and the class also we have. Okay, inside the java.lang package we have the object class, class also we have. See, this is the class only, class. It is the one class only. This is one class, this is one class. See, this is one class. Now carefully observe what I'm trying to do. In the class A, I have two attributes, non-static attributes. Param1, string first name. Int param1, string first name. In the M1 class, I'm creating the object of A class. Then, creating the reference to class. C1. Then, A1.getClass. A1.getClass. What happens here? Whatever the class, for this class, object will be created while calling the getClass method of the object class. Whatever the class, observe carefully. See, this is the class, right? In java.lang package, we have the class. java.lang. Oracle. This is the java.lang package. What are the classes we have in the lang package? object class we have. Class we have. Object class also we have. Class also we have. Now inside the object class, what are the methods we have? We know that. Now inside the class. Inside the class, what we have? Class. Public final class. That means what? This class cannot be extended further. Now carefully observe. We have so many methods inside this class. But inside the object class, what are all the methods we have? Clone method we have, equals finalize get a class. Observe here. We have get a class also. What is the return type? Return type is class type itself. Now, whatever the class, this class. For class. Observe carefully. For class. For class. Object will be created while calling the getClass method of the object class. For the class, object will be created while calling the getClass method of the object class.
I'm calling the get class method on the A1. I'm calling what? Get class method on A1 object. I'm calling the get class method on A1 object. By using object, I'm trying to get the information about the class. By using object, I'm trying to get the information about that object. By using object, I'm trying to get the information about the class. By using A1, I'm trying to get the information about that class. This A1 belongs to which class? This A1 belongs to which class? A class. Now, inside the class, so many methods we have. Inside the class, so many methods we have. See, object class members are available in every object, right or wrong? Object class members are available in every object. All the methods will be available for every object, means every class object. For every class object, object class members will be available. For every class object. Among all the members of the object class, there is a get class method also. Among all the members of the object class, there is a get class method also. We have seen that. Get class method. Inside the object class, we have the get class method. Get class method. Among all the members of the object class, there is a get class method. While calling the get class method, it returns an object to that particular class. While calling the get class method, it returns an object to that particular class. Now carefully observe. Inside this class, there are several getter methods. While calling the get class method, it returns an object to that particular class. Inside this class, there are several getter methods. What are the getter methods we have? Observe here. Inside the class, we have several getter methods. Get resource stream, get, see here, all the getter methods. Get declared classes, get constructors, get annotations, right? So many getter methods we have. Get declared, what is this? Get declaring class, get declared methods. Get field, get fields, right? So many getter methods. Inside this class, there are several getter methods we have. Through this getter methods, we can identify what are the attributes, what are the methods, and what is the class name, and what are the constructors are available. Then access levels. Okay, we can also know the access levels. Like several getter methods we have, okay? We have several getter methods. Depending on our requirement, we can able to identify which getter method we want to use. To know the schema of the class, to which object is created, Just call the get class method. It returns an object to the class. Inside the class, several getter methods we have. To know every information about a class, which an object is created. See why we are using the reflection API. what is the necessary of using the reflection API? Generally, class to object. Now, object to class. Generally, class to object. Now, object to class. Understanding? Generally, class to object. Now, object to class. By using that object, we can able to get the information about the class. Generally, class to object. But now, object to class. Reflecting the class information through an object. In any general object, there is a getClass method. And you'll be getting the class object. That class object contains several getter methods. By using those getter methods, we can able to find out every information about that object for which that a class is defined. We can able to get the detailed output. See, assume somehow we have one object. We don't know what is that object. Somehow we have an object. Just call the getClass method on that object. We will be getting class object. In that class object, we have several getter methods. Now, by using that getter methods, you can able to find out every information about that class for which an object is created. By using object, you can able to reflect the information about that class. See here, nothing is there. What is that? Carefully observe. Reflection API, generally class to object. By using reflection API, object to class. For a class, object is there. Generally, what we think, no? For a class, object is there. Class to object. Now, object to class. Now what happens? By using that object, you can able to fetch all the information about that class for which that object is created. By using that object, you can able to find out every information about that class by using the object to which, for which, you know, for which class that object got created. Now here, for A class, I'm creating the object. On A1 object, I'm calling the getClass method. GetClass method. Now it is going to create the class object. That the class object assigning to C1. Inside the class object, we have so many getter methods. By using those methods, we can able to find out every information about that class for which an object is created.
right or wrong? Through object, we are reflecting the information about the class. Now, c1.getName. Now, we will be getting the name of this class, A class. Pakka will get A. Okay, A class. This is the object of A class or not? A1 is the object of A class or not? That is what we are getting. Exactly. App6. Inside the app6, we have the A class. Inside the app6, we have the A class. We are fetching the name of the class for which an object is created. For which an object is created. Reflecting the class information through object. Reflecting the class information through object. Right? See, assume that you have one object. You don't know for which class that object got created. Simply call the getClass method on that object. Then you can able to call getName. Simply call the getName. You will get for which class that object got created. Right? Reflecting the class information through object. Empty. Observe it. It's already available. Now, in order to replace anything on the Eclipse, there is a shortcut, Control F. I want, see here, already A is there. Okay, I cannot use A in the same package. That is why I need to make it as B. Control F, find. Here, find the F. Here, it should give the case sensitive. Okay, case sensitive. Then, replace with what? Sorry, here, A. I need to give the A. Find the A. Wherever A is there, replace with capital F or capital B. Okay, capital B. A is already there. A is already there. That is what I'm replacing with B. Case sensitive, replace all. Close. B is already there. B is also already there. B is also already there. Let me find out C is there. C is not there. Okay. So what I'll do? Wherever here B is there. Control F. Wherever B is there. That I'm replacing with what? C. Replace all. Close. The current file, wherever B is there, that will be replaced with C. Now observe carefully. In the C class, I have two non-static members. Int param 1, string first name. In the M2, what I'm trying to do. Carefully observe. Object to OBJ reference. I'm creating the C class object automatically upcasted to object type or not? Right or wrong? C object can be automatically upcasted to object type or not? I'll be read. Object is what? Super type. C is what? Subtype. We can assign the subclass to parent reference. Alba, we can assign the subclass object to parent reference. Now what I'm doing, obj.getClass. OBJ is pointing to which object? C class object. OBJ is pointing to what? C class object. Now I'm calling the getClass method on the OBJ. Now it is creating the class object. Okay, this object. Right or wrong? Now it is creating the class object. Inside the class object, we have so many getter methods. Now I'll be using the getName method. C1.getName. Now I'll get for which class this object got created. That is for C class. App, what is this? App6. Okay, app6. App6 C class. Okay, app6 C class I'll get. Then here field is there. Field. See here, we need to import this field. Where field is available? Import java.lang.reflect.field. If it is in the lang package, directly we would have used that field. But it is not in the lang package, it is in the reflect package. That is why I need to import the field. Okay, if it is in the lang package, directly you can use. Okay, it is in the reflect package, that is why I need to import to use the field. Now what we are achieving through field? Field. Now field is an array. Field is an array. Now what we are achieving through field? Field array is equal to fields is equal to get declared fields. What we are trying to do? Simple. Whatever the declared fields are there, this is what we are calling field attribute. Field or attribute. Field or attribute. These are the two field or attribute of the C class. Right or wrong? Now, those fields will be returning in the form of array and we are storing inside the field array fields. Right? Two fields will be returning now. Two fields. What is that? Param1, first name. That is stored inside the fields. Now what I'm trying to do? Here, by using for each loop, I'm iterating through this field. Now field type, I'm supplying these fields. Now, for the first time, one field will be selected. Which field? Param. Now, field get name. What is the name? Param1. Albendry. Param1. Get type. What is the type? Int type. Separation. Second time. Get a name. First name. What is the type? String type. String type. With the package itself will get. With the package. Where this string class is there. Java.lang package. Type. Java.lang package string type. Name is what? First name.
Right, execute.
See, first I'm getting what? Class name. Then what I'm getting? Field. Param1 type int. Field name, first name. Type is what? Java.lang string type. Right? Through that object, by using object, we are able to find out the information about the class for which that object got created. Object to class. Okay, clear, sir. What are all the fields we have? I need to change this. Okay. Fields there. I need to change it to B. Control F. Wherever A is there, I need to change it to B. Let's all close. There totally how many? In the B class, totally how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 fields are attributes. 5 fields are attributes we have. Now in the D class, how many? 2. 2 attributes are fields. Now in the M3, observe carefully what I'm trying to do. In the M3, I have the main method. Now, wherever I need this operation, that operation I'm specifying in a separate method, okay, not in the main method itself. Simply I'm calling the test method, I'm passing the objection. Now carefully observe. I'm creating an object to B class, then that object can be automatically upcasted to object type. Now OBJ is pointing to B type of object, B object. That OBJ I'm supplying to test method. Test method is accepting what? OBJ. Test method is accepting what? OBJ. Possible. That OBJ is pointing to what? B object. Now, class symbol obj.getClass. Using this object, I'm trying to call the getClass method on this obj object. Now what it is going to do, it is going to create an object to this class. Now we have several getter methods. Using those getter methods, we can able to find the information about this particular object. Now c1.getName, class name pakkal get, then fields, we know very well c1.getter declared fields. In this case, c1.getter declared fields, we know very well field name field type. Field name, field type. Here, all this will be returning field name, field type. I field name, J field name, K field name, L field name, M field name. So this is a field name. This is a field type. This is a field name. This is a field type. Right? For the B class object. First class name, then field name type, field name type, field name type, right or wrong? If it is for D object, only two attributes, from one int, first name of type string. See, here, somebody is calling what test method, and we are the developer of the test method. So for the test method, we are supplying the object. Whatever we got the object, that object we are supplying to test method, and we don't know for which class the object is created. If I execute this method, pakka I can able to get the name of the class for which the object is created. And as well, we will get the all the fields information that got declared inside that class, right? Reflecting class information through object. If the interviewer asks this one, simply tell this. What you tell? What is reflection API? Sir, simple, sir. We will be reflecting the class information through object. How you do that? Explain this. Sir, first what I'll do, assume that I have one object. On that object, I'll be calling the getClass method. There, we will get the one class object. That class object, we are assigning to this class. Now, inside the class, we have several getter methods. By using that, we can able to find out the information about that object for which we can able to find out the information about that object. We can able to find out the information about that class for which that object got created. Okay? Right? Now, not only fields, we can also get the declared methods. Carefully observe. Is there? No. Fine. Wherever is there, replace with E. Replace all fields. See, we need to import this method. Method. Where is method available? In the java.land.reflect. Okay. Now, what are the declared methods here in the class E? Test1, test2, test3. And also we have return type, void type, int type, string type. In the M4 class. I'm creating an object to E class. S1 S1 is equal to hello, integer I1 is equal to 200. Okay. Now, I'm trying to find out the information about this object for which an object is created. I'm trying to get the information about the class for which this object got created. Okay. Now what I'm trying to do. First, I have developed info. Now it is accepting what obj. For this obj, observe carefully. For obj, we are supplying a1. A1 can be automatically upcasted to object type. A1 can be automatically upcasted to object type. Now what I'm trying to do. Get a class. Now by using get a class. See, by using any of, actually there are several getter methods. In the class. Depending on our requirement, we can able to choose the getter methods inside whatever is suitable for us. Get a class. Fine. Here, obj1.getClass, creating an object to class. Then, what I'm trying to do? Methods. C1.getMethods. Get methods. Method type using the foreach loop. Method. This is the method. Then variable. Then I'm supplying these methods to the for each loop. Now, for each iteration, method name, get the name of the method, then get the return type of that method. For which class? E class. In the E class, whatever the methods are there, and what is this name and what is the return type? Here, why we are getting all these methods? These are all the inherited methods from the object class, right or wrong? In the E class, inherited methods we have or not? Along with the declared methods, we have inherited method also from the object class. That is why I'm getting weight. Three types of weight we have. Overloaded weight methods we have. All the return types are void. Then equals method also, toString method also, then hashCode method also. Now here get a class method also, then here notify all. If you say just get methods, what I'm getting by default. By default, I'm getting what? Inherited methods. By default, what I'm getting? Inherited methods. For example, here, let's say object. See, by default, what we are getting? Inherited methods. Not the declared methods, inherited methods. To get the declared methods, there is a getter method, get declared methods, that we should use, get declared methods. M6. It's like beta. There are two approaches to load the class into the memory, right or wrong? There are two approaches, means one approach is what? Observe carefully. Whenever I'm trying to create the object for F, this F will be loaded to the memory. And then whenever I'm trying to create the object to F, F is not still in the memory, F has to load to the memory. When F is loading, all the static members will be executed, then only we are getting the SIB. Then we are getting the done. If somewhat, if this class couldn't be able to find out, we'll get what? Class not found exception. Class not found exception. Class not found exception. Class not found exception. Some classes there that cannot be, for example, then it is there or not? No, no, it is there. Come to the M6. There is a method called for name, class dot for name. This is another approach to load the class, to load the class into the memory, to load the class into the memory. Inside the class we have the for name. Observe, inside the class we have the for name. Will you there? For name, right? Returns the class object associated with the class or interface with the given string name. Now carefully observe. Class dot for name. Class dot for name. Now it is going to create an object to what? This class object. Right or wrong? Then here I'm supplying what? G. Now carefully observe. I'm trying to load the G into the memory. Now while loading G, this static member has to execute SIB. Now observe, I'll get what? Exception. Exception. What is that exception? Class not found exception. Okay. Why? In case of Eclipse, that will be using packages, right or wrong? Packages. G class will be available. G class available in the app6. App6 package. Right? Control F11. Now we are getting SIB done. Right? In case of Eclipse, you should use app6. Means anywhere, if you are using the packages, no, then you should use this syntax. If you are using the package concept, then you should use this. class dot for name. Now you know why we are using the class dot for name, to load the class explicitly. To load the class explicitly to the memory, we are using the class dot for name. Class dot for name. Come to line 7. N7. Carefully observe now. A, I'm replacing with H. Replace all flows. I don't know, this only taking this much time. Still, I have to do enum and assertions. After this, I need to do enum and assertions. See here, what I'm trying to do. If I'm trying to create an object to H, this will be loaded to the memory or not? For one execution, class will be loaded only once, not multiple times. Right or not? Now, once again, I'm trying to load the class by using class.forName, but H is already there in the memory. It won't load once again. App6. Now, one time SIPL we get, not multiple times. Right or not? Once the class is available in the memory, there is no necessity of once again loading the class into the memory. Come to the M8. What I'm going to do? Creating the iClass object, get a class. Now, class dot for name I, app6.i. Carefully observe whether obj1, obj2. Whenever class is loading to the memory, at that time, class object is created. Only one object is created. Whenever class is loaded to the memory, iClass. At that time, class object also is created. Only one object is created. The object reference is returning to obj1. The object reference is returning to obj1. The same reference is returning to obj2 also. Same object reference is returning to obj2 also. Sometimes we need to require to manage a class through a string. So class name is in one file. Okay, reading that the class name into Java program, that the class name available inside a string as a string object. That is why we are using the class.forName. See here, assume that our class is somewhere. Okay, I need to load that class. Okay, here what I'm trying to do, I need to keep the path in the form of string. Now carefully observe what I'm trying to do. Here, get a class. See, first what happens? iClass will be loaded to the memory, then SIB will be executed, then a1.getClass, I'm creating an object to class object, then already this class object is there, right or wrong? The same object is assigned to obj2 also. It won't be creating new object when I'm calling the class.forName. The same object is going to assign to the object. Now, class.forName I'm calling. Once again, it won't load. Why? Because already there, no. Already A class is there.
Now whether a1 double equal to whether a1 double equal to obj1, why it is saying incompatible? Why it is saying incompatible? Incompatible operand types. I end class. Carefully observe. I is different. A1 is of type I. A1 is of type I. OBJ1 is type of what? Class. We cannot compare both. Incompatible types. Incompatible operand types. I end class. See, I is the user defined class, but the class is the inbuilt class, right or wrong? I is the user defined class, but the class is what? Inbuilt class. So I'm trying to make a comparison between user defined class and inbuilt class. Not possible. This is also not possible. A1 and OBJ2. Not possible. But OBJ1 and OBJ2 possible or not? OBJ1 and OBJ2 possible or not? So what we get? True or false? True or false? Why? Because same object, no. Only one object is created. That is what I told. Here only one object is created. That object is assigned to OBJ1. Now it won't create the new object. The same object is assigning to OBJ2. Now OBJ1 and OBJ2 are same pointing to the same object. OBJ1 and OBJ2 references are pointing to the same object. Now if you print hash code also, here observe A1. A1, what is the hash code? Observe carefully. A1 is of type I. What the hash code I'm getting? This one hash code. Now OBJ1 and OBJ2 hash code. What are the OBJ1 and OBJ2 hash code? This is different hash codes. But these two are same. OBJ1 and OBJ2. A1 is different. Right? Very important. You want some break? One break or not? Still we have somewhat. See, I need to start this enum also. Enum and assertion also. If it is now, still time is there, no? 5 o'clock. Huh? That's it.
ಅನ್ನೋಟೇಷನ್ ಮಾಡಿಲ್ಲ ಅಲ್ವಾ, ಓ ಅದು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು.
ಅದರ್ವೈಸ್ ಐ ಡೂ ಒನ್ ಥಿಂಗ್, ಆನ್ ಸ್ಯಾಟರ್ಡೆ ಐ ಟೇಕ್ ಕ್ಲಾಸ್. ಸ್ಯಾಟರ್ಡೆ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಟೇಕ್ ದ ಕ್ಲಾಸ್. Anyway, your that web development is going on, no issues, that is different. Web development you need to take another 1 week.
Yeah. From tomorrow you won't be having class. 11 to 1. Okay? Only 1:30 to 3:30. 3:30. Okay? Starting new batch. 11. 11 to...
basic hours.
Yeah, basic. ಹಾಂ, ಸ್ಯಾಟರ್ಡೇ ತೊಗೊಂಡ್ರೆ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಆಗೋದು. ಇಫ್ ಐ ಟೇಕ್ ಸ್ಯಾಟರ್ಡೇ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್. ಸಿ, ಇಫ್ ಯು ಡೋಂಟ್ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ನೋ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಡಿಫಿಕಲ್ಟ್. ಶುಡ್ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್. ಓಕೆ. Actually, I have one class, another two class. Let me ask when he's going to come. For you, 3 plus 2, 6 topics. If you don't practice, it is very difficult. I'm telling you, you'll forget. You'll forget. You don't practice.
See, observe here till 5:30 will continue. See here, in type is the attribute, test one is what method. Now this is the field or attribute, this is the method. Now creating the what I'm doing class data for name. I'm loading the class, explicitly loading the class matrix dot. Matrix.j. Now this class will be loaded. While loading the class, an object will be created of class, then that will be assigned to C1. Now object to obj, C1.newInstance. See, by using this new instance, I'm trying to create an object to J class, right? This is another way. What is the first way? Buzzing new operator. Now this one, new instance. instance. Inside the class, we have the new instance with it. Observe carefully. Inside the class, we have new instance. Where is that new instance? Here, new instance. Creates a new instance of the class represented by this class object. Creates a new instance of the class represented by this class object. Now it is going to create an object to J class. It's going to create an object to J class. Now we are seeing this solid line on top of this new instance. That means it is a deprecated, old, legacy. It became a legacy method. In the annotations, you'll come to know what is this. Okay, deprecated method. Now, new instance. Okay, by using new, but still you can use this. Okay, still you can use this. New instance. Now, we'll be creating an object to do this J class. That object I'm assigning to OBJ. Now, that object can be automatically upcasted to object type. Object J class object can be automatically upcasted to object type. Now what I'm trying to do, field F1 is equal to C1.getDeclaredFields. So here getDeclaredFields, which field I want here, I field, right or wrong, one field I have, field name is what, I getDeclaredFields. Particularly I want to get the declared field I, that is I'm storing inside the F1. Okay, observe carefully, very important, F1. Now F1.setInt. Now OBJ is pointing to one J class object. OBJ is pointing to what? One J class object. OBJ is pointing to J class object. Now inside that OBJ, J class object, we have the field name called I. Right or not? We have the field name called I. That is what I have supplied to F1. Now, I is represented through F1. Now, on F1, I'm calling the setInt. Now, this is the object of type J. In that, we have the field name I. For that field name, I'm setting the value 20. Right or wrong? For that field, I'm setting the value 20. Now, what are all the declared methods we have? How to invoke the declared methods? Observe here what I'm trying to do. C1.getDeclared method. Then, which is the declared method? Test1, I have the declared method. Test1. I'm supplying the test1. Now, this test1 will be represented by this M1. Represented by this M1. On this M1, I'm invoking OBJ. Now, internally, this object contains test1 method. Internally, this object of J type contains what test1 method? Internally, this OBJ. OBJ of type what? J. This object contains internally what? Test1 method. Now, we are invoking the test1 method. We are invoking the test1 method. Test1 method will be invoked. From test will be printed. Now we are printing the value of the getInt OBJ. That is what? 10. 10 or 20? 20. 20. Here 20. First, what you'll get output? Answer carefully. What is the output? First output you'll get from test, then you get 20. Okay. From test, then 20. Get declared methods. Get declared method. M9. Here observe, instead of get methods, get declared methods I'll call. Okay, get declared. I'm getting only these three methods, declared methods. Only these three methods. Only declared, not the inherited. Okay, not the inherited. Only declared inside the E class. That is what I'm getting. Name of the method, type, return type. if you say simple methods. Methods. What you'll get? All the inherited methods? Right or wrong? What are it? Now, if a method is taking parameter, how to invoke that? Right or wrong? If a method is taking parameter, how to invoke that? What I'm trying to do, we know very well how to create the instance. Then get a declared method, whatever the declared methods are there, that only. Now get a declared method, see, so many get declared methods we have. Okay, now which one I'm using, which is taking two arguments. One is what? Name of the method, then argument. Right or wrong? Name of the method, then argument, return type. Argument is what? What type of argument it is accepting? String type. Now, string class. Okay? String is class or not? Of course, no. String is class only. String type. That is why I am specifying string.class. Now, m2.invoke obj. Obj. It is pointing to what? Test2. Then I'm passing what? Hello. Now I'll get from test2 hello. From test2 what? Hello. From test2 hello. Right? M11. See, there might be a chance of taking multiple arguments, right or wrong? There might be a chance of taking multiple arguments. How to invoke that? H3. Now these are, what is this for? What we are calling? Overloaded method. Creating the instance, then get declared method. Test3. For the test3, observe carefully. So what I'm trying to do here, carefully observe, get a declared method. Where is get a declared method? Get a declared method. Observe carefully. Get declared method. Where we have get a declared method. One is the name, string name. Okay. Then class, parameter types, class type. Okay, that is how we are passing different classes. String class, comma, int class, comma, double class, right? Now this is what we are calling. This is what we are calling variable number of arguments. Okay? Variable number of arguments. Varark. You know about Varark? Varark. Here we have covered Bararch in the wrapper classes, maybe, right? Bararch. See here, three dots. See, simple, what it is doing. See here, second parameter, it is taking variable number of arguments. That means different classes. See here, first argument is what? String only, string class. Second argument is what? Int class, int data class. Third argument is what? Double class, double only it is accepting, like that. Then invoking this m1, supplying what? Only one. Hello. That is only it is accepting. Now invoking m2, then three arguments I should pass. One is string type, another one is int type, another one is double type. Then one line. Class not found. Here app 6. M12. What I'm trying to do here, return value. Okay, return value. Observe carefully what I'm trying to do. Test 4 return value is what? Test 4 return type is what? Int. Returning 4 ones. Now, creating the object, get declared methods, test 4. Now, what I'm trying to do? Invoking what? Invoking the what? M4. M4 is pointing to what? Test4 method. Now, when I invoke this, it will be returning what? 4 ones into value. That is what I'm storing inside value. Invoke. Invoke method return type is what? Object type. See here. Invoke method return type is object type. Now what I'm trying to do. This integer, right or wrong? Observe carefully. Invoke method return type is what? Here we have with this invoke. In which class we have this invoke? Here, inside the method. Okay. java.lang.reflect.method. Class method. Here, invoke. Where is the invoke? Object. Okay. Class method. field summary, method summary. There is invoke. Yeah. Okay. Invoke. Now return type is what? Object type. That is why. That is why. What I'm trying to do. I'm storing inside the object. Okay. I'm storing inside the object type. Now, what happens? The return value will be of type what? What I'm getting here? Here, integer it is going to return. Integer. Object type it is going to return. Object type. Now, what is the returning value? Int type. In the integer form, in the integer, integer is what? Class type. Integer is what? Class type. Now that integer, that is going to return. Integer. Integer it is going to return. Now integer can be automatically upcased to object type. Integer is a subclass to object type. That is why it is automatically upcased to object type. Otherwise, you can also use this one. This syntax, no issues at all. Syntax. This syntax also works fine. We are what we are doing? Converting to integer, object to integer, and then only we are supplying to integer. See here, directly can able to supply. Here, type mismatch cannot convert from object to integer. That is why. First, I'm trying to convert to integer. Then only I'm trying to convert. Supply to the integer. You can also supply to integer, or you can also supply to object. No issues at all. Okay. Now that is how we are retrieving the return value. That is how we are retrieving the return value. Okay. Last program. Here, what I'm trying to do, in the N class, we have the N constructor, and also we have the method. Now, observe carefully. Reflection API demands no argument constructor. If at all we want to use the new instance method is always using the no argument constructor to create an object to specify the class. Okay, always you should put no argument constructor. If you don't give any constructor, compile will be generating no argument constructor. But you cannot have what? Argument constructor. You cannot have argument constructor. Why? Because always here this reflection API demands no argument constructor. Why? Because new instance method is always using what? No argument constructor to create an object to specified class. Okay. To create an object to specified class. We are using the reflection API to create an object to N class. We are supplying the class name in the form of a string. Class name app6.n. We are supplying the reflection API. We are using the reflection API to create an object to N. We are supplying the class name in the form of a string. If it is so, N class should be having no argument constructor. Reflection API always uses no argument constructor. So internally, which method is using new instance? New instance method always will be calling the no argument constructor, not the argument constructor. Now, we are not creating the object, right? We are calling the new instance method. New instance method is creating the object. In the body of the new instance method, it is using the no argument constructor, not the argument constructor. If at all, somehow no argument constructor is there. We'll be getting the instantiation exception. So explicitly, we have given the no argument constructor. Assume that I don't have these two. Now, execute. Works perfectly fine. Why? Because compiler only keeping the no argument constructor. But here, I don't have the no argument constructor. I have the argument constructor. Pakka will be getting error. Exception. Instantiation exception. Instantiation exception. Java dot like that. Instantiation exception. Right? Why? Because new instance method will be always using the no argument constructor. No argument constructor. In the body of the new instance method, it is always going to call the no argument constructor, not the argument constructor. If you don't have any constructor, compiler only keeping the no argument constructor. That is okay. But if you are using the new instance of method, compulsory should have the no argument constructor, should not develop any argument constructor. You can have the argument constructor, but along with that, you should also have the no argument constructor. That is also possible or not? Better or possible? Always, always it is going to call the no argument constructor. Understood? So this is all about the object class. Next is, maybe I'll start assertion, then enum, then annotation. That will continue in the next class. See, please practice. Otherwise, object class is very confusing. Okay? Should practice.